for locomotive research and infrastructure. My name is Somrat Gatsvan from King Mongkut University of Thailand. So in this session consists of four presentations. I would like to inform that each presentation we have about 30 minutes. Let's say 25 minutes for presentation and 5 minutes for question and discussion. For the first presentation, it will be presented by Mr. Kishor Raut. So Mr. Raut graduated with the degree in mechanical engineering from Bombay University and then started working at Associated Textile Engineers after graduated in the field of engine testing, textile equipment and pollution control equipment. And finally, he set up on individual path by establishing the Dynamic Control Buni in 1996 as a total solution provider in the field of engine and vehicle testing equipment with data acquisition and control system. So please.
Thank you very much, sir. Good afternoon, gentlemen. First of all, thank you very much for inviting us to this workshop. We Dynamic are manufacturers of engine and vehicle testing equipments for automotive applications, steel locomotive applications. This is about me and my company. We design and manufacture all engine testing equipments, especially eddy current dynamometers, regenerative dynamometers with AC transient dynamometers, with DC motors, DC servo, AC servos, along with data acquisitions and real-time embedded controllers, right from automotive applications till locomotives. Parallelly, we are, giving services for integrations as well as turnkey project along with data acquisitions and integrations of mechanical and electrical services required in this particular field. Now I will request our Mr. Pense to give, insight of consideration for test cell design for locomotive engines and research. Mr. Pense, please take over.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is regarding the engine test facility for locomotive engines. The consideration, now the overview of this is what? In-house testing of the locomotive in future, present, and past, present, and probably in future, what is coming? It is explained. Now, till now, the engine used to be tested with the load bank. That is, whatever power is generated, it used to be absorbed. Now, it has got a certain drawback. One is the wastage of energy. Another is the inadequate accuracy in the results. Third is the inadequate safety, because the load bank, it is generating lot of heat. Sometimes the people use very crude method of water tank and heating the water. This is the whole thing is open, probably in DLW it is like this. So inadequate safety, plus more space is required for, because that capacity of load method, and because of lot of heat is dissipated in the atmosphere, it has got some environmental related issues also. To overcome these drawbacks, now people have started using the hydraulic dynamometer. Now the advantages is that hydraulic dynamometer, you can automate the test bed. Means the whole testing can be done unmanned and finally you can get the result in a printout. This is a better accuracy, probably plus minus 1.5% of the full scale, then real-time control and data acquisition is possible. Cost-effective, less space is required. Heat generated is absorbed in the water and safe operation. So whatever the drawbacks in the earlier method, this is taken over. Now the latest trend which has been tried out by one company in Pune, that the dynamometer is, they have used the AC transient dynamometer for testing a demo engine, that is a railway, that is a diesel electric multiple unit. The system features are high dynamic response, very low inertia, then the wide speed torque and curve in closed loop, built-in control, then motoring feature, means for engine starting, whatever is the motor is there, with that you can crank the engine, no separate starting mechanism is required. And
friction.
And less frictional power and regeneration. See, whatever power is produced, that can be used in the same plant. Completely air-cooled, means no water is required for cooling the dynamometer. It's an air-cooled machine. Correct. However, from the cost consideration, this system is high investment oriented. Means compared to the hydraulic dynamometer, this cost could be about 4 to 5 times. And it is non-practical for locomotive engine, because the volume of engine, number of engines are very less, and doing this size of investment, probably most of the time it will not be under use. So for a long run, the recovery of the electrical energy may not work out to be economical, but since this has been done very recently, this fact is still theoretical, it is not yet proved. So what is the payback period in terms of number of years? Only one incident where AC dyno is used for testing locomotive engine all over the world. In fact, that AC dyno, practically that supplier has also manufactured it for the first time. Now the design consideration for the locomotive engine test setup. Main is the adequate space around the engine as well as the sufficient headroom above the engine, just to for a better heat dissipation. Otherwise, the hole, if it is a small one, whatever heat is generated, it is just within the test cell and the test cell temperature increases. Then engine entry in the test cell, it is from the ground floor. Now yesterday you must have seen in RDSO, the engine entry is from the top. The roof is open. The huge engine is lifted and then it is dropped. It's a very, very unsafe practice. So everywhere the engine is coming from the ground floor, and lifting of the engine could be about 800 to 1 meter maximum to lift it and put it on the test bed. So engine handling also becomes very easy. The third is a control room is elevated with respect to the test cell floor, so that during the testing, the operator has got a very good view of the engine which is under test. Because the main concept is, when engine is being tested, nobody should be inside the test cell. All doors should be closed. The test operator should come, he observes the engine. If he finds something abnormal visually, then he can stop the engine. So to get a better view, the control room floor is elevated. Depending on the size of the engine, how much it is, that is to be decided. then this creates one more problem of safety in the test cell. If the control room is elevated, the operator has to go in and out in the test cell. He has to climb up or climb down two or three steps, which is absolutely unsafe. This is nowhere it will be accepted, because in any company, the employer's health and safety application manual, you will find no step within the factory. So for to overcome that, the test cell floor near the engine, false floor is provided, so that the control room and the test cell floor where the operator movement is taking place, it is in the same level. The use of coolant conditioning. Now, in this particular case, we recommend when the engine is tested, engine coolant, that is the engine cooling water, temperature needs to be controlled. So there is a coolant conditioning system which is maintaining the coolant temperature during the test, because when performance is taken, the certain temperature of the coolant needs to be maintained. So to take care of that, the coolant conditioning system is to be provided along with the coolant recovery. Means once the engine is tested, before taking out the engine, the entire coolant, at least up to 90% of the coolant from the engine, is to be recovered back, so that the same coolant can be filled in the next engine. If that is not there, when you are disconnecting the engine, lot of special coolant that is wasted. And the third is the power absorbed by hydraulic dynamometer. These are the design considerations. Now I will show you certain layouts where I got the opportunity to make the two setups, one for R&D and one more for the production purpose, where I said earlier AC transient dyno is used for testing. So these two setups have been designed, manufactured, installed, commissioned, and it is being used for last about 3 to 4 years. This is whatever I am showing the layout is not a concept, but which is in practice and being used. Now, this is the layout of a overall layout of the setup which is used for production, where AC dyno is used. Now I will explain. Now, this was made initially for two test cells, but the provision is there to extend for total 6 number of test cells. So at present these two test cells have been commissioned and it is in use. Now you will see, this is the rail on which the engine is placed. Here is, now this is the door. This engine cart with the engine is coming from the assembly line. This is a battery operated. The cart comes inside. It stays in this zone. Now here there is an overhead monorail from which the engine is lifted and placed it on this. Now the whatever lifting is hardly about 500 mm, not more than that. Now if you see, there are two rails here and two rails here. This rail is for engine mounting and these two rails for mounting the clamps which are operating by pneumatic. They are operated by pneumatically. So during the testing, the engine is clamped. So that and the cart goes out. Now this portion where generally the operator movement is taking place. So this portion and control room both are kept in the same level, which I have mentioned earlier that there should not be any level difference. Now these are the grills and there is a trench, and this also continues to change below this false floor to carry the wastewater into a underground tank, from where it is sent to the this is the control room. This is the door for operator to go in and out. Now I will show you the cross section. See, this is the cross section of the test cell. This is the door. This is the here operator door. There is a vision panel through which the operator can see the get the good view of the engine during test. Now this is a floor level which is elevated by 800, and this is a false floor on which the operator, and here it is a false ceiling. The above the test cell is, we call it that as a plant room, where the ventilation blower and the cooling unit is provided with the fresh air supply is given in the test cell to maintain to the temperature inside the test cell during the test. Now here there is a cooling tower. Now, and though here is a AC dyno, but water is required for the engine coolant conditioning, so the cooling tower and water is still required. This is an underground tank. So the return water which is coming is under pressure. That is why that water doesn't come in the tank, but it goes directly to the cooling tower. From here, this is a pump house in which the water pumps are placed, and these pumps through overhead this thing entering the test cell. This is the space 800 mm through which it enters in the test cell. So it is not providing any hindrance for the operator also. So this is the cross section of the test cell, horizontal. This is the foundation block on which the two T slot and rails are there, and the engine is placed. This is the side trench. On that earlier slide, you have seen here in this portion there are gratings through which whatever water it goes in the trench. Now this is a false floor. And this is the I-beam for 10 ton monorail for lifting the engine from the car and placing it on the T-slotted rail. Now this is a typical plant room layout above the test cell. This is the blower which I have shown in the cross section. For that quantity it was 65,000 CMH air is required. Then hot air is removed. These are the actual flow fan through which it is released in the atmosphere. So water circulation, air circulation is taking place. Now the area through which the front door through which the engine is coming inside, that side view is like this. When doors are closed, these are the door. These are our 3.5 meter wide door through which the engine comes. When the engine is loaded, all doors are closed. So this is the overall setup which has been in use for testing locomotive engine for production. Now there are some photographs. When you will see, this is the grating, this is the cart, then again here, this is the grill, this is the false floor, then this is the overhead engine exhaust which is coming overhead, nothing is going below the false floor. These are two additional views.
here it is going, it is really there. So now I will show you the setup which has been made for R&D. Now this setup, the basic technical data and the design parameters are like this. Now the engine, this setup is made suitable for engine rating 1500 kW to 4500 kW engine. It's a range of engine. Then the power absorption by hydraulic dynamometer. The dynamometer used is a Taylor make USA. The space required, that is the whole setup. If you see this complete setup, the space required is 35 meter by 35 meter. That is over 1,225 meter square. It means the entire setup with all services have been accommodated. Test cell dimension is 13 meter by 8.5 meter by 8.5 meter height. Then the control room is 7 meter by 2.5 meter by 3.5 meter height. Underground water tank is 8 meter by 4 meter by 3.5 meter. Now the usable capacity is 85,000 liter. Underground fuel storage tank of capacity 10 kiloliter. Day tank, it is a 990 liter because that is the maximum we can provide without any approval of high explosive. This is allowed. Fuel farm, that is the underground diesel tank where a bulk storage is done. That area is 10.3 meter by 9.3 meter. Inside the test cell, there is a EOT crane of 15 ton. When engine is coming on a trolley, it is lifted from the trolley and placed it in the on the test bed. Cooling tower, there are two cells. Flow rate is 280 cmh, and the operating temperature of cooling tower is 60 degrees to 30 degrees. Mean delta T is 30 degrees. At Wilbur temperature is 26 degrees. And there are two chip cranes provided in the test cell to support the exhaust pipe, because exhaust pipes are also pretty big. When they are routed to the main header, they need support. Now we will go into detail. Now, this is the main test cell. This is the length, this is the width. Now the engine from assembly line is coming on this rails, and it is coming on a trolley inside the test cell. Now the overhead EOT crane is lifting the engine from this and placing it on this engine loading block. This is a hydraulic dynamometer. And here, this is the door, there is another door made here. Now here, the control room. Now actually, in any engine testing setup, the control room is never kept at a right angle to the engine axis. But here, there was no choice. The client was insisting that we want it here, but with the full knowledge, they have done it. Normally it should be somewhere here opposite to engine entry, because whatever any damage of the engine takes place, the components, they fly in this direction and never in this direction. So that is why the control room is never kept at a right angle to the engine axis. But this is what the client wanted, so we done it. Now this area is provided for storage of gaseous fuel, that is the CNG and LNG. From this, it is entering inside, and then through the fuel meter, it is supplied to the engine. Now, this is the fuel farm. The dimensions I have shown earlier. Now, this portion is a underground diesel tank with these openings. Now, this is the unloading platform on which the trailer is coming inside. The trailer is coming in. Now, for this setup and with all the necessary dimensions, the approval is required from high explosive department, which is there in Nagpur. The layout has to be approved, then only we can install it. After installation, all local authorities and government bodies, there are about 13 to 14 agencies whose approval is necessary in the form of no objection. Then only the consent to use underground tank is given. It's a very time consuming and require a lot of legal procedures. Now here it is a diesel pump through which, and then diesel is supplied to the tester. Now this is a water pump area. These are the two underground tanks. One is the hot sump, cold sump. These are the two cooling towers which I have shown in this, two cells with 280 cmh water flow. This is the cross section of the test cell. Now this is the EOT crane of 15 ton. They are the side, this thing, here it is a control room. Again you will find the control room is railed compared to the test cell floor. And this is the exhaust pipe connected to the engine. And these are the jib cranes which are supporting the pipe. Otherwise, it is very difficult to connect also. Now this is a general setup. Now individually we have got the drawing of individual service. Now we will see the individual service drawings. Now this is the engine exhaust disposal. This is the engine. Now you will see this red color, there is a common manifold and there are four openings have been given. Now these four openings means this setup is suitable for 1500 to 4500. Depending on the capacity of the engine, the exhaust position keep on changing. To match that, these are the four optional points are given. Wherever possible, it is to be connected. These are the four openings through which the exhaust gas is passing. It is taking a bed and it is taken out and it is let out in the atmosphere through the rain hood, because in this even any amount of rain, the rainwater doesn't enter in the exhaust pipe. There is a special design through which the water is released from the side pipe and only the exhaust gas is going out. Now this is the structure. Actually it is...
Sir, 5 minutes. 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Oh.
Make now, it quick.
I will just... Now here, we have provided a residential silencer so that during the testing of the engine, the sound level outside the test cell is not more than 75 dB, which is well within the limits. I think it is now I will there are other drawings also, means fuel farm, water circulation, water pipe routing. There are a lot of drawings are there, but now I will show you the actual photographs of this setup. Now this is the setup. See, this is the cooling tower area. this is the one cell, another cell. These are the pumps supplying to the cooling tower, and then the cold water is coming from here to the cold sump. Okay. So here, these are the dynamometer. This dynamometer actually, each one is absorbing 2.5 megawatt. With, if I have got an engine of say 1.5 megawatt or 2 megawatt, I can decouple this and use only one unit. But if I get a single unit of 4.5 megawatt, probably the accuracy is affected when the small engine is tested. So this is a typical selection of the dynamometer. Next. Now this is the exhaust pipe. These are the four connections, and this pipe is going out. See, these are the chip cranes supporting the exhaust pipe. Now here another view, you can see this is the outlet of the cooling water which is coming here and going down. And there are four distinct outlet pipe. Now this is the suction pipe to the pump, and the water is going to the dresser. Now these are the pipe coming from the pump house through the trench, and these are the quick coupling for connecting to the engine with the very quick coupling with the camlock type coupling. And this is the fixture. This is again T-slotted rail. So this much length so that we can accommodate the one. This 1.5 as well as 4.5 megawatt engine. Right? Now this is the diesel pump, which is pumping the diesel from the underground tank and supplying to the test cell. Now, in the hydraulic dynamometer, most critical is the maintaining the supply water pressure. The whole accuracy depends on that. So this is a special pressure control valve supplied by the dyno manufacturer only, which is very heavy, and there are special supports are required to be given because this is about 10 kg weight, so floating, so there are support required. Okay, thank you.